gradients, which to a non-neural network person kind of sounds like paint, but it's not. It's a new paradigm in training neural nets, and Anuj is going to tell us all about it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Today we're going to look at something called synthetic gradients. This was a work. So what we're going to largely look at is a new way of training neural nets as compared to the known paradigm of back propagation, which is at the very heart of training any neural net. I want to make this clear upfront. This is not a work that I have done. This is a work that came from the DeepMind team last year. And I was basically surfing around some stuff on Reddit when I came across a thread which was having some interesting discussion around this work, and that kind of caught me a little interested, and I tried to read up this work. It took some time, I would be honest, to even understand what were they doing and why were they doing the one thing. But then I realized that while many of us are struggling with the basics of deep learning, trying to have some neural net, some deal going for us, there are a bunch of people who are working on the completely other end of the spectrum, who are trying to do how do you train massive neural networks, and this is what this work is going to be all about. So what is, how do neural nets learn? Ultimately, we pose learning as an optimization problem, and at the heart of training any neural net is what is called as back propagation. The idea being, you have a loss function, you understand the gradient or how the loss is going to change when I'm going to change one of the variables by a small amount, and then you use that as a signal to update your weights, which is the gradient. It is also called as error gradient. This was proposed way back. Difficult to say who was the original author of this work, because there was a lot of work that came around at the same time. Anybody interested in the history can look at this link. So let's do a quick refresher on what is back propagation for the interest of everyone. So what I have is a simple neural net which has one node which is doing an addition. It along with another input node is doing a multiplication. So this function, this small network you're trying to approximate is x plus y into z. And imagine we are starting with values of x, y, and z as given below. So what is that we are interested in? So what we are interested in, that how the function is going to change as a rate of x, y, and z. By how much it's going to change if I tweak my x, y, and z by a small amount. So let's try and compute it from base. So what we know is the partial derivative of f with respect to f is going to be 1, which is easy. What is partial derivative of f with respect to z, given you have the function f as defined? We know it is simple, x plus y. In this particular case, for these set of values, it will be 3. Now comes the partial derivative of f with respect to q. Again, pretty easy because that is x plus y. So you know it's going to be z, which is minus 4. It is here because you have the error signal which started from one end of the network, which is back propagating to the origin. We'll start to use the chain rule. And what is this says? It basically says this, f is a composition of q and y. So the very derivative of f with respect to y will also have those compositions, which we know again in this case is z minus 4, and similar is the story up here. So this is what is called as the back propagation. So the error started from one end of the network, and the error is back propagating to the origin of the entire network. Now in a nutshell, if you think what is happening is, where these boxes represent nothing but the layers of the network. So fi is the fi layer of the network. We have a forward flow where, starting from the input, you are doing a forward pass on your network, and each layer is making its computation as by the very, very definition of F. And then it is passing on to the next layer, which is using that as an input, doing the computation, which is shown here by the black arrow. So starting from Fi, it goes to Fi plus 1, it goes to Fi plus 2, so on and so forth. On the other hand, what is happening is when this flow is going to go till the end of it, that is when you're going to have the output, which you're going to compare against the truth, that is where the error starts. So the error is the gap between what was predicted and what is the truth of it. And what you start to have is a back propagation where the error signal starts to go back all the way down. So you have the layer I, which takes the gradient from the previous layers, does the computation, which is the multiplicative of its own, and then passes on to the next layer. So what we have is a backward flow, which is shown by the black here, and we have the forward flow, which is shown by the green here. Now, this is how every neural net that is there is trained. Can you think, is there a problem with this? I mean, this is something we all have been doing. Anybody who has trained any neural net, at the heart of it, this is what we do. Is there a problem with it? Yes. And here is the thing. Actually, what it is introducing is, it is introducing locking between the layers. And what do I mean by that? So if I model the entire network as a directed graph from layer 1 to layer 2 to 3, which is L1 to LN being the N layers, one, there is a forward locking. What is forward locking? Now, this layer cannot compute this forward signal until it gets the signal from here. So the layer Li needs to wait for the signal to come from Li minus 1. Which in turn needs to wait for Li minus 2, which in turn needs to wait, so on and so forth. So this layer in a way is locked by all the layers on all the way to down. So this is what we're going to call as the forward lock. Similar is the story for the backward lock. So if you remember what was happening, we were computing the loss here. We get the gradients, we percolate those gradients back through this layer, then to this layer, then to this layer, and so on and so forth. Which means in order to have how much error is happening at the ith layer, I need to wait for the error signal to come from the next layer, which is Li minus Li plus 1, which in turn needs to wait for Li plus 2 until Ln. And this is what we're going to call as the backward locking. Both of them together, so in order to update, so each layer has their weights, their parameters. I want to update these parameters. I can't do until I have the gradient, the error signal. So what is going to happen? I cannot update until all the layers subsequently have done that and have passed on the signal to me. And all of this, which is the forward locking, the backward locking and the update locking, is forcing the network that these layers be trained in a sequential manner. You cannot go beyond that. Now, all of us have been doing deep learning for some time. I mean, it all works fine. What's the big deal? So, the kind of networks most of us train are relatively small. I mean, there are some efforts where the kind of networks they train are massive. I mean, look at something like an AutoML project from Google, which has a couple of hundreds of layers in the network which are being trained. Now, imagine such a network being trained where the layers are locked and the entire network needs to be trained in a sequential manner. And when I say it is layer by layer, so you have a forward pass and then you have a backward pass. The question they tried to ask is, it is all good for the small networks. If you have massive networks, this is going to create trouble. And can we do away with this? And the idea being, can we learn each layer in an asynchronous manner? Can I break this locking? And this is what essentially this paper does. This is what they call as the the decoupling of the layers? Can I break this locking mechanism that is inherent to this backpropagation algorithm? How does it help? As I said, this is, if you have massive networks, you can train each layer independently, which means if you have a cluster of machines, rather than having these layers being locked and this dependency being there, you can train each of them independently. But how do you do that? So first we will try and do away with what I called as the backward and the update. So what is very clear to us is that if I want to compute the gradients of the ith layer, I need the gradients which are coming from the I plus 1 layer. I mean, without that I can't do anything. But because of that very fact, I need to wait for the whole forward path to go from this layer to the last, compute the error, then come back, then finally get my error. And I'm not okay with that. But if you think carefully, 1 and 2 are contradictory. They appear to be contradictory. I have to get the signal from the next layer, but at the same time, I don't want to do that. So they came up with an idea that it is possible to do away if I am willing to make some error in my computations. And the idea was the following. So for the talk, I am going to consider delta I to be the actual gradient. If I would have done a back propagation in the normal way, whatever gradient I would have got for the layer I is going to be delta I. And what they do is, let's not compute this delta I. Instead, let's try and estimate the gradient, whatever it is. So, how do I do this at first place? We will see this later. I mean, let us first see if we have such a facility available whereby you have an approximation of the actual gradient, how are you even gonna use it? So what we assume for now is there are some magical boxes that are available to every layer, to which if this layer gives some input, it's gonna return me the approximation of this. Okay? So I'm gonna assume for some magical reasons I have these oracles available to me, which I'm gonna use. So every layer Li has access to a magical box Mi plus 1, which when queried with some input, it will give me an approximation of the actual gradient. This estimate is what they call as the synthetic gradients. So what is happening here? I have a layer. This layer does a forward computation. It produces an output Hi. This is sent to the next layer. And at that very instant, this Hi is sent to the oracle. So each layer has an independent oracle to them. And this returns me the estimate of it. Now, the moment this layer has the access to this value, which is instant, I'm going to treat this to be my actual gradient, and I'm going to update my weights. I'm not going to wait for anything at all. So now it has become instant. I just do the forward computation. I just send it to the magical box. It returns me a value. I treat this to be the actual gradient and just execute the computation that I have to do. So each layer uses the synthetic gradients to update their weights, barring the last layer. And why? Because last layer is going to produce the output, which is going to be computed against the actual output, the truth. You're going to get the error, and you can instantaneously anyways get the gradients for the last layer. So it's only the last layer of the network where the output comes, where the synthetic gradient is equal to the actual gradient. Rest, all the layers gonna work with synthetic gradients. There is no actual gradient to them. So now that we understand, if we have synthetic gradients, how can we use? Let us try and address the question, how can we produce those synthetic gradients? What are those magical boxes? Magic doesn't happen in real life. So let's try and build something for that. So what we had is, we have the layer which takes Hi as an input. So we have this box which takes the output of this layer as input and it returns me the gradient. Now what is that it wants to do? What is that this magical box wants to achieve? What it wants to achieve is that it wants to be as good an approximation of the actual gradient as possible. So I want my synthetic gradient to be as close to the actual gradient as I can. And how can I do this? Use another machine learning model to do this. So what are we going to do? Imagine there is a machine learning model that is powering this box. It takes some input signal, which is the output of this layer, and it produces this synthetic gradient. And at all times, this model is trying to do is get this estimate as close to the reality as possible. So what they show is this can be done using a simple shallow networks. You don't need a very heavy machinery. But there is a problem. What is the problem? The problem in this entire thought is I want MI plus one, the magical box, to correctly produce the synthetic gradient. The way it's going to do is it's going to learn from the actual gradients. The actual gradients are going to come from the entire flow of the forward pass and then the backward pass where I get the truth. If this was to be done, why did we at all do this? How do you circumvent this? Am I clear as to what has happened until now, right? Cool. So the problem is, how do I get, if I have to wait for this, then there is no point of doing all this mumbo jumbo. So they said that you don't have to really do that. If you are willing to allow some more error, you can circumvent that. And how do you do that? So imagine this layer. So this layer also had a magical box, which is MI plus 2. This layer did a forward computation, sent it to the magical box, which sends the synthetic gradient. All I do is I take these synthetic gradients of this layer, just back propagate through this layer, and whatever comes out, treat that as the actual gradient. So I have a delta I, which is the approximation of it. This is the true gradient. And the way I approximate this itself is by taking the synthetic gradient of the next layer and back propagating it. So these are the three key terms we need to remember. Am I clear with this part? Now, so what has happened till now? So this is a very nice image they had put up. So I have a layer which takes a forward signal. It does a forward computation. This computation goes in two parts. One to the next layer. Second, it goes to the magical box. The magical box receives this signal and just returns a synthetic gradient. This gradient is used to update the weights and finish off. But at all point of time, we want this magical box to make better approximations, for which it needs to see the actual gradient, which I further approximate by taking the synthetic gradients of this layer and just back propagating them. Now, if you think, it's only the last layer which is seeing the true picture. All the other layers are working with guesses. Now, what you have done, if you think, is you have decoupled these layers. Each layer is now completely independent and can do the updations instantaneously. Yeah, so the only one it is dependent on is the next layer. But that layer has access to a magical box by which you get the instant gradients and get back. So what you have achieved is you have broken the essential dependency that we saw, where I need to complete this full forward pass and then full back pass to be able to do the updations. All layers can do updation in one step at the same time. Brilliant. Now that is a question. I mean, you have done so many approximations, great, as an idea it works, but what about the quality of the training? So what they did is, they took certain networks which had multiple layers to them. And they took the most popular data sets from the vision world, where you have very well established benchmarks. They ran the normal back propagation, and this normal back propagation, this is the error that is there for each of those networks. So this was a three layer network which produced a error of 2. 4 layer, 5 layer, 6 layers. It's a well-known fact. If you keep on increasing, you will keep on getting better. So this is what is called as a fully convolution. This is a convolution where here you have fully connected layers in the end. Here it's all convolution. But this is DNI, the decoupled neural interfaces, this idea that they built. If you look what is happening, as I increase the number of layers, the gap in the error keeps on increasing. So here it's pretty close. It increases slightly, it increases more, it increases more. For the other data set, the story is very similar. So all the approximations that you made are actually making you pay in the quality of the training, which in a way is a setback, because you ultimately want to replace the back propagation. So they came up with a nice idea. They said, to this magical box, what signals to send is in our hands. Can we send more signals and see if it can do better? So what they did is, what they call as DNI conditioned on label. So what we saw is where the layer was doing the forward pass, and whatever is the output was going to the magical box. What I do now is, along with that answer, I also send the label of the data point. So that is what is called as DNI conditioned on the label. So instead of giving a single signal as an input, I now give 2 signals. One is the forward computation output. Second is the signal of the class of the data point. And what they were able to show is that for the error now comes much more in control. As a matter of fact, it does pretty well. If you see all the numbers across both the data sets. Now, this is from the error quality. So what you show is this technique, when given along with the label given to these magical boxes, the error is in control. But what about the amount of time it takes to converge? Maybe in order to do this, you do a couple of hours, while it takes a couple of days here, which will not be a good news. So that is the second aspect of the quality we want to understand. So they did more and more experiments around it. Let me help you understand. So the grays and the blacks are again different networks of sizes, the number of layers. And if you see all these, so this is basically showing how fast it is able to converge to the optima, right? So if you think, see carefully, the whites and the blacks and the grays are actually sitting over here. I hope you're able to see, Now, this is the DNI, the original idea that we have, the blues and the greens. Now, they try and converge, but even after a lot of iterations, I'm only going to come here, I'm going to come here. I think, okay. So, this is where you're sitting, your normal back propagation. This is where the DNI idea is sitting. What about the CDNI? It was able to control the error. Can it also take care of the speed at which the error can converge? And this is what they found. They found that the reds and the yellows are below. As a matter of fact, surprisingly, the yellow is even below the gray for most of this iteration. So if you look at the curve of yellow, here it's all above gray, but somewhere here it starts to go down much more dramatically. Now, what have we gained out of all of this? They seem to be hinting at that if you increase the number of layers, things surprisingly only start to get better, along with the speed up that you are anyways getting. And so are we done? I mean, this was a whole idea. A bunch of people, well, as I said, most of us struggling with basics, some of them trying to see if massive neural networks can be trained in faster ways. This whole idea, does it work? So we got rid of the backward and the update locking. But if you think carefully, our layers are still forward locked. which means no layer can do the forward computation until it gets the signal from the previous layer. That is the part left. And what they do is they apply the same technique even in the forward pass. So this image might look little daunting, but let me explain what is going on. So this is a data point. It has a label to it. These are my layers. Each of these layers has a magical box to it. So this comes to this, it does the forward computation. This goes to the magical box, it generates the gradient. This is then passed to here, and so on and so forth. Now what do I do with the forward passes? I still need to break that. So how do you do that? Have more magical boxes that can predict even the forward computation. So each of these eyes takes the original label and tries to predict what the previous layer would have sent. So you have HIs, which is the true forward value. You have the HI hats, which is the approximation of it. And this box is trying to reduce the gap up here. They further show in the paper that this whole idea can be applied even to RNNs, where you have back propagation through time. Things only become complex. I actually could not put that because the image and the maths starts to go really complex. But the very same idea can be applied and it can be worked through. This is the original paper that came. There was a follow-up paper from the same team. I tried to implement this idea. I have put up a GitHub repo. Any of this who is interested can, in order to facilitate a better understanding, where what I've done is I've converted back propagations to objects. Each layer starts to act as an object. So I've shown how you can implement the normal back propagation through it, and then show how you can implement the same idea as a synthetic gradient. So why I wanted to put this talk across is that when I first read this, I thought this was a bizarre idea. I mean, for somebody to even think that something which is at the very heart, we have all taken it for granted, they have shown that there are limitations even to that algorithm, and have tried to see if we can have workarounds. And they have used machine learning to solve the problem of machine learning, which was interesting to me. So this is the end of talk from my end. Any questions? Happy to take it up.
Just a second, we'll get you a microphone.
Does that increase the computational resources required by three times, because or two times rather?
So when I showed this, here everything else has been kept the same. So the only thing that has changed are the network configurations and the training algorithm. So essentially what you surprisingly find it, beyond certain point it actually starts to do much, much better.
When are you approximating inputs as well? Isn't the increase the error?
So they show that it is not the case. So using the similar idea where you use this to approximate a better of this, they actually show that the error remains pretty much in control.
I have one quick question.
Sure.
When you say that the time taken for the complete network to perform the modeling task, talk about iterations. Now, one iteration in one complete model can take 1 day, and one iteration in this model can take 3 days. So in terms of time, in terms of seconds, how well can you say that this system will perform better than the regular back propagation? Because I see that there are about I1, I2, I3 which have to be modeled at the back end before you even start doing this task.
Not really, right? You can start this up front because this signal goes to all of them in parallel in the same go. So one thing is, initially those approximations will be bad. I mean, of course they will be. But the whole idea is that with time, they are going to see the actual value and going to refine, and they also learn in parallel. So here one massive model and each of them is a single neural net which learns independently. So as she said, in this figure there are 7 neural nets which are training in parallel to achieve this. But the point is, you are leveraging the power of many lightweight models to be able to train each of them in parallel. I mean, this becomes much more clear. Imagine you are training a ResNet, right? 150 layers. What do? I mean, it takes huge amount of computational resources. If you look at their meta ML that they are going after, I mean, one of the articles seems to claim it has close to 500 layers. I mean, how do you train such a thing? It's a beast of its own. Yeah, but the point is, each of them can work independently. That is the crucial point that is happening here. All this needs is the initial signal, and then whatever is, if this signal was fed to this, what would have been the reality? For this to learn, this is the whole world. It does not need to bother with what is happening in the rest of it. Its job is only to take this signal and then see what is the truth of it, and then build a better approximation so that I can better predict in the next iteration.
I'm Sai Swaroop. So, following up on that question, do you have any numbers on actual time taken in terms of seconds? So, is it comparable? Is it 2x? Is it half of the time? Or?
So the paper, I mean, I hope you understand it was not possible for me to train such kind of network. The kind of resources you need,
yeah.
My pocket doesn't allow that. But what they showed in the paper is that the actual time is only utmost that they saw. It was utmost a 2x increase in the time per iteration.
So what's the gain then we are getting it? We are losing on accuracy and we are spending 2x the time.
See, it is per iteration. It is only per iteration. The number of iterations you need to converge is actually going lesser.
No, it's only 20% less or something like that, number of iterations, sir. So that so, converge at 500, this converge at 400.
Yeah, but then, so currently actually they are in the process of trying these with 40 layers and 50 layers. I mean, this was only an initial work where they tried with until, if I think 8 or 10 layers, and they saw promising numbers coming out of them. So,
yeah.
So okay. That is the bet they are putting on.
So, there is more work going on.
Of course, I mean, this cannot be the end. I mean, they are gaining, they are gunning for networks with 5.5, which have much larger number of layers, so.
And also, how promising is this on higher number of layers, like 100 layers, 150 layers? If you go back to the slide where it showed numbers, actually it shows that...
This is right?
Yes. So it shows actually, as the layers increases, not just the difference, but actual accuracy is going up. Actual error is going up. So if you see...
No, error is coming down. This is 1.8.
On the DNA.
See, of course, DNA was bad, but yeah. They also came up with a fix that just by having one additional signal, which is a label of the data point, which is cheap, I mean, that is there with you, I can actually come down and do better.
Okay. So, but there are no published results on higher number of layers?
Not yet. I mean, those are the only two papers I have come across on that work.
So, my question is, because you have so many neural nets acting in parallel, right? Would you always ensure that you're going towards a minima all the time, because it's all over the place? You can suddenly have an error which can cause the cost overall cost function to climb up, and then so it somehow I don't think it's, I don't know, what are your thoughts on that?
So two things. One, either prove it theoretically that it is always going to converge and do it better. I am not sure they are anyway attempting that. They are depending on the age old idea of machine learning. You run lot of experiments, you start with different conditions and see if there are aberrations. So until now, they have not seen anything like that.
Does it like zigzag a lot, and does it suddenly spike up, come down, stuff like that?
See, that is more from the point of, given an error surface, how well can I do over there? And there have already been advances much beyond what we know as the gradient descent, where there have been far more sophisticated techniques to be not only to ensure that you can avoid certain pitfalls, but you can quickly go to the goal. I mean, see, the loss functions of neural nets are not as cute as we have seen in many other ML things. So here also they have not found anything which is abnormal, I would say. I mean, it's a well-known fact they are never the nice, beautiful world of the convex. But that is true for any neural net that we train.
This question is more in the practical life. More in the practical life. So these data sets are very small in some sense, right? Let's talk about, like, you know, the really large scale data sets and so on, right? Where you typically apply dropouts and so on to optimize for convergence and, you know, performance and so on. Now, you know the nuances of backprop and dropouts and so on. So at this practical setting, where does these kind of methods stand?
See, one, I don't see how the size of the data set is going to affect this technique. I don't think so that has any bearing. I mean, the idea only being, because you are doing a lot of approximation, then those approximations are only going to increase more if you have more layers. Because each one is starting with a bad approximation of the next one and so on and so forth. It's only the last layer which has always been seeing the true picture. The initial ones are promising, the larger ones, I would say that is a work in progress, it's only much later can we...
Okay. Then what about the dropouts, right? So where, you know, randomly some nodes have been turned off and so on. Now, I mean,
yeah,
that be practical here.
No, that has not still been trying, I mean, see, even around dropouts, there's only so much that we know. Why they work and how they work. I mean, large parts are still, because this comes from Jeff Hinton, people just follow. To be actually be able to understand, there's only so much insights into, of course, there are certain explanations, but still there is no clean explanation. Have they tried in this? The answer is no.
There's some connection to bagging, but yeah, it's a different discussion. But
yeah. But the most interesting part they found is that the same technique when applied to RNNs, which use back propagation to time, also works beautifully.
Okay, one more last question, right? This is typically the DNNs with, like, you know, feed forward networks. So let's say you do a data parallelism, right? Where, you know, you shard the data across multiple nodes, and, you know, there is a distributed optimization which is like optimizing for your parameter updates and so on. Mm. Now, if I compare that method with these methods, where do you see?
So initial attempts have been all about the fully connected networks, I would say. You having setting where your network itself is dynamic, your network itself depending on certain flow of data takes different paths, on all those things, this is a very long shot, but no, around that there is nothing much, at least, there's hardly anything on this. There's just a couple of Reddit threads that are available where these discussions are available.
Sure, thanks.
There's a question over here. Can we bring the mic over?
I have just one comment to make. In gradient descent, the major problem to solve is vanishing gradient problem. The neurons get saturated over the time and the gradient gets dying because of this back propagation. So, I mean, I would just like to know your insights of whether that problem will be solved when we are decoupling gradients altogether.
Okay, so vanishing gradients is not just for this. I mean, if you look at the entire world of RNNs, vanishing gradients are there. And why did LSTM do better than RNNs? Because one of the major things, I mean, gradient explosion is something that is taken care of by the clipping part of it, which is a very standard technique, where where the why LSTMs did better is because they made the gradients additive instead of multiplicative by having a memory inside it. That is how the addition happens. So even if a lot of small numbers add up, they can still give you a significant number, right? That is the whole idea of LSTM and the various models that have come in. Now, that does not have any role to play here because the gradients are still in a way flowing. See, it's not that you have broken the hierarchical dependencies that are there in the network. The hierarchy still sits. I am still dependent on the next layer for my synthetic gradient to come for. But that is all where the dependency goes. It does not go to the forward and that's all. So that should not have any effect on that, right? No, I mean, LSTMs have already solved, right? I mean, so if you're, I mean, if you're training RNNs, or which is backpropagation through time, it should continue to do fine. I mean, I don't see any reason why. No, I mean, why do LSTMs?
LSTM are very focused on recursive neural networks. Oh, sorry, recurrent neural networks.
I mean,
right? That's where.
If you look at LSTMs in the entire genre that has come across, which, where there are settings, there are highway networks and non-highway networks and stuff like that, LSTMs have moved past that problem of gradient vanishing thing. And the whole idea being there is a memory where these gradients add up rather than getting multiplicative. So if I add a lot of small numbers, I can get a significant number. I'm never going to multiply a lot of small numbers to go much more insignificant.
Okay, sure. Thanks.
We are just about out of time for questions. I'm so sorry. This is such an interesting and very deeply technical talk that I am sure that those of you who are into it probably have a million questions. And perhaps, Anuj, take your questions offline later. We're going into another talk next. Thank you very much, Anuj. Thank you.